Thanks, Rana, and thanks to Rod and everybody else, Claudia, the people who organized this. I feel like, you know, all those, you know, when you're trying to promote a book, you say a lot of grandiose things about it, you know, and I hope you took them with a grain of salt, you know. I mean, boy, but like the things that I was claiming for that book, I wouldn't, you know, claim for Moby Dick. You know, forgive my exuberance. And the volume's okay? I'm very tempted to just rip the microphone and send it away, but I'm hoping the depth of my voice will carry in this fabulous hybrid room, which is like part my grandmother's dining room and part bunker. Those are machine guns, are they not? They are? Okay, so I'm going to read a handful of poems from Jeremiah, and then I'll read some new poems. I'm about halfway through what I hope will be my next book. I've got some new ones that I'd like to test on you. But I'll start with Jeremiah. Like that introduction said, it is a kind of novel in poems, and it is, I did steal liberally from the book and from the story of, from the book of Jeremiah, including some of the forms, like most biblical books start with an invocation, so this book also starts with an invocation. These are the words of Jeremiah, the son of Hank, of the failed farmers and short order cooks who tilled and tore the soil of southern Ohio in the days that became years that became confusion. These are his words, poor bastard, who roared himself ragged during the reign of so-and-so and his valiant pals. Hear the summons, O wanderers and worriers. See me pulling the planks from your porch. Woe unto ye, corporate communicators. Behold the oily ends of your extended lunches. Yea, I have been sent to root out and pull down, to lubricate and decimate, to build and to plant. Who will accompany me on my trail of frustration? Who will lend me a button? I have seen and will give voice to my grief. I will be delivered COD. May the words of my mouth and the declamations of my fury tear holes in the outerwear of the people. Let them feel the hot gust. So that's a taste of what Jeremiah sounds like. Bruce, the other character, is, among other things, kind of a student of Ohio history. He's also a little nuts about counting syllables, but the Ohio history thing means that a lot of his poems have titles that have sort of bizarre little factoids about Ohio, such as Chillicothe was the first capital of the Ohio Territory. It's two, and once I've dropped off my load of loaves and Twinkies at the State Pen In and Out, I can spend the afternoon smoking at the Indian Mound State Park. Dispatch doesn't need the van till 5:30, and each cigarette burns off a little of the day's shame. No one's looking for me here. But halfway through my first fire, I can hear a man at the gate standing with his arms outspread like he's trying to call down the rain. He's making roaring noises in his throat, and when the ranger asks him to move along, he starts yelling, "What unrighteousness have your fathers found in me that now they are gone from me?" Something like that. The ranger is just a kid, probably working off student loans, so I say, "Listen, buddy, do you need a ride or what?" Right away, he grabs his army duffel and slings it into my truck. He sits on the floor in back next to a crate of snowballs. Then he asks, "What is thy name?" I can hardly keep myself from laughing, but I answer, "Bruce Gray, scholar and bread man." Jeremiah shakes my hand and looks straight into my face. His hands are already scarred and yellow with calluses. "Are you upright and holy?" "Sure." "Can you transcribe the words I speak?" "I can type if that's what you mean." "Good. I thank you for your kindness. It will not go unnoticed if you catch my drift." "I catch it. Drive on." At the flea market. All along the riverside, my towns are breaking down. my delis and Mount Oribs, my New Harmonies and crowns. I lost my heart at Dairy Mart for lack of home-baked bread and blundered into wonder and was crushed like a possum on Route 32. Will you hear, O my people? Will you heed my bells and whistles? Will you teen girls worrying your split ends remark on my resonance and tears? Where can I go to find solace if even the restrooms are for customers only? Yea, the women of Williamsburg are selling suitcases at the Sunday Jubilee along with ceramic geese and rifles. What can they learn from me except that their villages are vanishing? Behold, they are sitting on a bowl that has been dropped from the table. Like a potter's toy, we must be refired. They know this well. Their town is an astonishment and a hissing. They should know better than to recline on lawn chairs and bake their bellies like berries. O fair-haired mothers, O mole-chinned grannies, remove your orange sunglasses, reveal the squinting of your hearts. Be not worse than your uncles who sowed wheat and reaped thorns in this asphalt pasture. Save your old yards with their hopeful black-eyed Susans and their weary black-eyed Susans. You don't have snowballs here anymore, do you? They're like Twinkies, except they're pink and round and covered in coconut. And I think they're extinct. So Bruce, that's what Bruce has been, he's got what's called a step van, those kind of vans, like they're UPS trucks or step vans, because you can step in and out of them. So he's got the van and reasons to leave town, and he takes up with Jeremiah, who needs a ride, and food. So they start wandering around these towns, starting off in rural Ohio. Those towns, Chillicothe is sort of... right in the middle, but in the southern section of Ohio, but they've started off in southwestern Ohio, and they work their way eventually north and east. This is their modus operandi. In the beginning, in the towns he knew, he'd have a specific place in mind. But as we moved east and farther from home, he would start murmuring in the cab when he'd seen a spot that needed a good talking to. Donut shops, gas stations where the loud displays clashed with the postures of the women behind the counters. The boxes of cakes didn't last as long as I thought they would when we left home. I interpreted Jeremiah's rants as half politics, half religion, but what compelled me was their warped music, something necessary and unique. I would pull over and just let him go. In those first weeks, it was almost like I was dropping off my father for his regular game of canasta with his old war buddies. It was that casual. After, he'd collect his clothes and hop back into the truck humming, still buzzing with the words and the response he got. He'd wipe the spit off, and we'd ride away with the laughter and the dismissals trailing behind us like a kind of exhaust, half believing we'd done some good. Occasionally, the police would get involved in running us out of town, but usually we weren't around long enough to attract much attention. Once I got the hang of his timetable, I'd take the opportunity to pick up groceries or gather my notes. By June, I'd filled 7 legal pads full of his speeches, but still didn't know what he wanted me to do with them. At night, by firelight, he would read his day, grunting. Sometimes he would scratch things out. I realized now that he was forming his philosophy as we traveled, or receiving it, in preparation for what would happen to him later. So, I'm tempted to read one more Jeremiah one, but I'm going to keep moving. So this is one of the poems that are written in the voices of other characters they meet along the way. Some of the characters are intrigued, interested, none as much as Bruce is, I guess, and some of them less so. This is one of the guys who's less so. This is called Ashland Radio. Ashland is in, we're already by now on the northeast section of Ohio. There he was just walking down the street singing, good day, sunshine. Then he goes raising the roof, crashes into me wearing that same old shaggy dress. I'm thinking, what's it all about? He wants to hold my hand. He's funny that way. I'm like, you'd better watch your step. You'll be a woman soon. He shouts, lets it all out. I know now, it's your destiny to be the king of pain. So here we are, now entertain us. He started talking at me, get up, stand up. It don't mean nothing, not this time. If you want to sing out, I'm your man, roam if you want to, but nothing's gonna change my world. He can't hold back, falls into a burning ring of fire, calling out around the world. Something in my heart keeps telling me don't talk back, but enough is enough, can't stand no more. I hit him with my best shot, whoomp, there it is. His eyes too bloody to see. I could have danced all night, but Jane says, don't be cruel, take me to the river. No rap fans in the room? I can usually tell a little something about the audience when I read that one. Got more from the 50s from Motown today than from the womb. All right. It's good to know. All right, so soon after this event, the events of Ashland, Jeremiah decides that they should go to the center of iniquity, which, if you live east of the Mississippi, everybody knows is New York. If you're west of the Mississippi, I suppose you could say Los Angeles, but Las Vegas might have a claim. But we don't have to worry about that, because we were east of the Mississippi, so they're on their way to New York. This is called slopping in the rain between Wadsworth and Poe. Yea, in the city I will speak the truth. Hey ho, the truth in the place of iniquity. I will warn the people in their linen hearts. I will tell them to turn, turn, turn. What more can I do but harangue when the sky hangs precarious like a vase on a lawnmower? How can they fail to hear me when they know I speak straight from the source? Their cell phones are magnets pulling them to another blank signal. The people are lost without their wonder. They fuss and fret, but have no fury. Yea, I was sitting amidst the wrenches and petunias when the voice of the Lord came ringing down like a game show winner's fanfare. It said, who will seize my country with conviction? Who will lead us into a new season? Yo, I said, I'm your man, send me. But you are tarnished and despoiled, sad fool. You could not even care for a boy. How can you save the whole people? I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. And the last one I'll read from Jeremiah's, sort of Bruce's response to that, which is called Akron's History is Colorful, Painful, Diverse, and Inspiring. That's from Akron's city website. Some mornings he would wake me by declaiming while he pissed, but others I'd blink awake to find he'd cleared the campsite and washed my clothes, hanging them on convenient pine branches. He'd wait till I was fully alert, then he'd say, come now, and we'd be at it again. Before, I thought about how this trip was helping me find a tolerable version of the self I thought I'd lost, but it was only after that awful night in Ashland, nursing him, calming him down, that I started to believe that I was meant to be here. A little sympathy, a little frustration and luck, and all of a sudden you find yourself at the center of something that becomes who you are for a while. Not quite an accident, more like a mistake you were prepared for. So they go to New York and bad things happen there. Things happen there, not just bad things. But you'll have to read it and find out. I've got, I think, five new poems newish, some are newer than others, that I want to try out on you. The first one we were talking about, I became a Canadian citizen in November. I was right, thanks. So I'm pulling. Should I bow? I don't know. Hey, thanks. It was a bureaucratic nightmare. Which means that I'm pulling for Vancouver tomorrow. I don't know why. All right, because I'm Canadian now, even though I'm from New England. But this is, so while I was first doing this, this poem is actually a couple of years old, and started, the first draft of it started on a train ride from Toronto to here, to Ottawa, when I was first sort of thinking about this, what it means to be a citizen of a country, either country, in my case, either one. So it's called Toward an Idea of Citizenship. I'm thinking of my country as a girl drinking coffee in a drizzle after her boyfriend has gotten on the train. Her dyed black hair is piled on her head, this morning's cobbling together of last night's style and fire. Her eyeliner is smudged, but not from crying. She sips from the cup, thin shoulders folded under the boy's windbreaker. She's got work in an hour. Saturday's bleary-eyed afternoon shift better than jealous Friday nights. She'll have time at the register to wonder if what she's so sad about is him going or just knowing what comes next. There is always a girl saying goodbye to a boy who is leaving the shit bin they call home. She is always wondering if he will return, if he will send for her, if she will be stuck her whole life while he goes on to become a partner in some firm and father brilliant children with a woman from the city whose father did the same thing 40 years ago. There are always the women in the city who know the names of artists and designers and have elaborate ambitions instead of impulses and regrets. And there is always the boy who is blank with the change, whose only chance is to forget everything, who hates the town for being so familiar, who hates the girl for staying and himself for leaving, who hates the train, the sky, his oily face, the traces of kisses on his neck, and most of all, the insistent pulse that pushes him toward whatever it is in this forsaken world that he is going to become. Engagement. The young man knows he's going to die today, but he's wrong. The other young man figures the army is the best way to improve his life, but he's wrong. They both think their weapons will protect them, but they're wrong. They both believe their prayers will help. Their commanders have intentions and intelligence, but they're wrong. We've heard the story before, it's wrong. The news will document it, but it will be wrong. The war on terror, the war on Islam, the clash of civilizations. The explosion will exceed the necessity of the occasion. The exchange of fire will be unbalanced. The response will be disproportionate. The reporter is factually incorrect, theoretically misinformed, morally reprehensible. The clear typeface and perfect binding are misleading. The reader is uncomfortably and inappropriately implicated. The tranquil mind is insufficient to the task. The young men, next dirty and damp, advance. I don't want to call these, like, I got some, like, they're not political exactly. I don't, I wouldn't, but they're social, or they're something. They're in the world. So this is sort of a poem that's trying to be in the world. It's not quite succeeding. It's called Thinking About Egypt. This is my newest, this is pretty brand new. Earlier there was a windy ribbon flattering the screen like a thing that should be evocative of something. Then there was an avocado dangling from a no parking sign. There were other things around also, if you catch my meaning. Hey, what will you bring to the party, chips or beer? Start with what you mean by mean, OMG. Sometimes when I say mean, I mean say, and sometimes I mean intend, even when intending doesn't mean anything. No one believes in subjectivity anymore. All the inventors of perception and doubt have vanished into the abyss. On the other hand, it's very clear that meaningful things are happening in Egypt. Old men kicking stones, refuting me thus, young men throwing them. Don't say présenter when you mean introduire. But wait a second. We're trying to think entrepreneurially. I'm talking about synergies. The clouds overhead are a landscape worth cultivating and flipping for twice the sell price. Don't start on that again. Just wait until the Floridian returns from his sojourn on the slick. I don't know if that's done yet. Paul Vermeers, who's a poet in Toronto, has started a website called They Will Take My Island. And it's got its title from a painting, a Maxim Gorky painting, which I admit I don't know much about. Andy Wharton and I, we were talking, he knows a lot about visual arts, and I know about music, I know very little about visual arts. So this painting was new to me. So what Paul is doing is gathering people, he's got a constraint for, it's an assignment for poets. He's asked some of us to write a poem with the title, They Will Take My Island. So when he started this, I was teaching a Shakespeare class. So I didn't, not knowing anything about Maxim Gorky, but teaching The Tempest, I thought of Caliban. So this poem is called They Will Take My Island. And there's an epigraph from The Tempest. You taught me language, and my profit on it is I know how to curse. They will take my island if I don't scorch it to the bones. Though, to speak truly, I did not know it was an island until they said so. I thought it was the world. The river fish would drift into my clasp, and I would gnaw on their flesh while the gills still gasped. It had edges and pleasures and dangers. What more is a world? Then they arrived with their instruments. They taught me so much about my home, it became strange, as my body became strange when it bloomed. They renamed the birds after their own birds. They taught me to sing for them and to delight in singing for them. I watched their plots evolve as a monkey watches a jaguar wrestle a snake. Then one day they gathered on the sand, and my princess held the hand of a young god, and I cursed myself for a fool, and the drunk bowed his head, and a pig was cooked, and even I was given a piece of hoof to suck on. And they sang a song and climbed onto some felled trees and sailed away to heaven, leaving me to the wordless noises. I returned to my caves and corners, but couldn't remember what to hide from. The jaguars had been slaughtered. The fish tasted raw. I sat on a stone and tried to imagine what to think of myself. They will return. How can they not return if they spoke of this place so enchantingly? And how can I not try to prevent them now that I know it is mine? How can I not resist them with my very teeth or with the perfection of a purging fire? Every sunset, I ascend to the heights of my puny kingdom and scan the sea for sails. All right, I've got one more. I'm okay for time? I'm good for time? Because this one more is a little long. Not that long, it's a little long. It's also got an epigraph. This epigraph is from Ron Artest, who, if you're a basketball fan, you know that Ron Artest is one of the most insane professional basketball players, a real nut job. But occasionally comes up with moments of brilliance, like the following, which is about Pluto. So the poem is called Dwarf, and it's sort of about Pluto. And this is the quote from Ron Artest. I grew up with Pluto as a planet, and now I'm 25, I turn around and Pluto's no longer a planet. I gotta find that guy and elbow that guy in the nose. Dwarf. For one day, I will not be ironic about the power of art. For one day, I will try not to be ironic about the power of art. Tonight, the president will use his best rhetoric to make a case for more. More blood, more effort, more death, more debt. Some viewers, pretending to understand, will evaluate his performance for the rest of us. I will sit in my love seat and wait for insight. I will detect this insight by way of an inner ear organ that knows, that believes it knows, insight when it hears it. My inner ear likes the president's rhetoric. Sometimes it sounds like insight. At other times it sounds like a man's voice in search of insight. For me, for my inner ear, the sound of this searching is as close to insight as is usually available. In other news, Pluto has been demoted to a dwarf planet by the IAU's Working Group on the Definition of a Planet. It has something to do with lopsidedness and something to do with lack of influence. Bodies that dominate their neighborhoods sweep up asteroids, comets, and other debris, clearing a path along their orbits. By contrast, Pluto's orbit is somewhat untidy. And so the children weep because on their cartoon maps of the solar system, Pluto, the ninth planet, has been replaced with an unhappy face. They write poems to their congressmen who can do nothing. But today I have promised to stand by the claims of art, to believe in things that, while as far from the tables of power as Pluto is from Plato, to believe that they may have, that they may, They may. Fire and desperation and hunger and belief, how to account for them? How to measure their significations? What can the cockeyed orbit of Pluto teach us about our earthly sufferings? Chen Li wrote, "Traveling in the family of poetry is the most substantial and warmest link on the lonesome journey in the universe." If Mr. Li wants to learn about loneliness, he should go to Pluto, whose orbit extends to 7.4 billion kilometers from the sun and where there is no poetry, though plenty is hurled hopefully up on its behalf to no observable effect. It is a truism that, like a child, art has no inherent use and is often a draw on our resources. As my grandfather once wrote, "Why do men write poems? Why do men live?" In those days, men meant everyone, but recently the masculine general has been declared a dwarf pronoun by the IAU's working group on the definition of pronouns. It will be a long winter on Pluto, 100 years roughly. Here it is the season of fallen fledglings. They litter the sidewalks of this bulbous city, some attracting flies, some cheeping stupidly, asking for help from parents who have done the math and moved on. Sometimes storekeepers scoop the birds up into shoeboxes and try to save them. It's hard not to believe that Pluto would be insulted by its recent reclassification as a dwarf, which puts it on par with Eris, the goddess of discord. Discord is only halfway to hell, but it's also bigger. Meanwhile, art has been declared a dwarf pursuit by the IAU's working group on the definition of pursuits. No, I have promised. We are moon makers. We take balls of ice and blow on them until they seem to hover or achieve an untidy presence that the president may refer to when he casts about, helplessly looking for a way to explain. Pluto has three known moons: Hydra, a monster, Charon, the ferryman to oblivion, and Nyx, his mother, who is oblivion. Even oblivion has an orbit. Even oblivion bends the light. Thank you very much.